Hello friends, this is Vedavati Varkala working in Narayana IAS Academy. We have started a new program called Prelims 2020 Made Easy. Today, we are going to see a topic from history which is related to socio-religious movements. We are going to see all the social, religious and cultural reasons for the reform movements during the late 18th century and 19th century. See, during that time, India was in a vicious trap. There was black magic, there was blind faith, there was idolatry, there was polytheism, which means believing in many number of gods, believing in superstitions. In most of the things, logic was missing. Everyone blindly believed whatever were customs and traditions since the ages. And it is also because of high position of priests and their version of scriptures. See, these priests, only some section of people used to have access to reading the scriptures, and they had the power to persuade and convince anyone that this is right, that these are given by the gods. And if you don't follow them, we can bring sins. Like that, they used to persuade anyone. And there was impact of British rule also. Like, see, they were indulging in practices that are against the religion of majority. Like, in 1857 revolt about the greased cartridges and about crossing the sea and about Christian missionaries, like that the British were involving in the religion. So because of the impact of that also, and there was depressing position of women. How was it treated? When a girl is born, it was totally unwelcomed, and there was marriage burden regarding a girl, and widow is considered as a bad omen. Even now it is still prevalent. That is so sad. So see, there were some foolish practices like sati. According to Rajaram Mohan Roy, sati, it is considered as a murder according to every shastra. See, he was a person who read almost all Eastern and Western scriptures. So he used to say, this is murder according to any shastra. And there was the caste problem during that time. Almost 20% of Hindu population of that time were treated as untouchables. This caste problem is not only in Hinduism, but it was also in other religions. And there was opposition to Western culture. See, during this time, Christian missionaries came. They were trying to modernize the people. They were trying to make people like Indians in blood and European in character. That's why Indians felt insecure during that time and they opposed the Western culture. Also, there was awakening and enlightenment of Indians. There are some educated youth, right? Educated middle class. They began to give up old traditions. See, there were two sections of people. There were orthodox and conservative people on one side opposing Western culture and British, and on the other side, the educated sections, they thought our customs and traditions are really foolish. They have no logic. So they used to give up old traditions. They started consuming beef also. They started having wine, and realization was happening in that sections, in the educated sections. And there were reformist movements going on. Reformist means changing the form. Like if there are some conservative, orthodox and foolish ideas, they're going to reform them. That is beneficial to the society. For example, Brahmo Samaj, Pradhana Samaj, Aligarh movement. These are all some reformist movements which try to promote good among sections. There were revivalist movement also. Arya Samaj, Deoband movement. These are trying to revive the old traditions only, but they want to revive it for the good of the people. See, everybody were trying for good only, but they had different ideologies. Some wanted to change it altogether. Some wanted to revive the same old traditions, but in a beneficial way. So the nature of this reformist movements was, initially the reasons were all related to religion only. Everybody were thinking our religion should be promoted, or some sections thought the religion should be reformed. So that's why it was a very narrow social base. But when this movement started on a large scale, it went to diverse strata. So slowly, it started dissociating from the reason of religion, not just religion. There were later, it penetrated to more and more strata of the society. Now we will see what are those problems during those centuries that led to socio-religious movements. And we are going to see who are the persons associated for the reforms of their problems. See, this is going to be very factual lesson, not conceptual, but these facts are very, very important for the prelims. They might ask you in MCQs, match the following or correct or incorrect pairs. So you need to remember the persons, the movements, the years, chronology, what are the organizations associated with those persons, etc. First, we will see what are the women problems during that time. See, the irony of those time is female gods were glorified. Like we have Lord Saraswati, Lord Lakshmi, Lord Shakti, right? But next to them, the female members are suppressed. See, they treat females as goddesses, but in reality, they suppress them. And women were considered inferior to men. And the women were depending economically and socially on men. And there were some ill social practices like sati, where the wife has to die along with the deceased husband. And there was parda, covering the face. She can't go out with showing her face. And there was ban on widow remarriage. And there was child marriage, literally at the age of 8, 9 or 11 years. And there was female infanticide. This is the serious issue. Like whenever, as soon as the female is born, she was killed. Also, there was no identity of their own to women. Hindu women cannot inherit property and they have no rights on divorce. In Hindus, they cannot inherit the whole property. In Muslims, they can inherit only half of the property. And polygamy was prevalent in both Hindus and Muslims. These were all the problems faced by the women during the 19th century. So who all are the leaders and what are the movements associated for reforming the problems of women? First and foremost is abolition of sati. Sati is, see here, her husband has died and the woman also should sit on the pyre to die along with the husband. This is sati. So in the year 1829, Rajaram Mohan Roy, he worked so much for the abolition of sati. He is from Bengal. So during that time, the Governor General was William Bentinck. So under his generalship, the abolition of sati happened in 1829. It's very important to remember the year. Three questions can come. In which year it happened? Who is responsible for the movement? And under whose Governor General? And female infanticide, killing the female infants, was also stopped by the regulations of 1795 and 1804 Bengal regulations. And in the year 1870, they passed an act to register as soon as a female was born. This is to check the female infanticide. And who all worked for the widow remarriage? See, Brahmo Samaj. Rajaram Mohan Roy founded this Brahmo Samaj. We will be dealing about in detail with this Samaj. But for now, remember, Brahmo Samaj worked for it. And Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, he is the very prominent person in the case of widow remarriage. He is responsible for bringing the Hindu Widow Remarriage Act 1857. This is one of the most important act for the upliftment of women. And there is another person called Karson Das Mulji. He wrote Satyaprakash in Gujarati. And he also advocated widow remarriage. See, this can come in prelims. Who wrote Satyaprakash in Gujarati? It is Karson Das Mulji. And there was another person, Vishnu Shastri Pandit. He found Widow Remarriage Association. And there is another important person, D.K. Kharve. See, he himself married a widow. He did not just fought for the cause, he himself showed it. And he was made the secretary of Widow Remarriage Association. See, it was found by Vishnu Shastri Pandit, right? So he was the secretary, Kharve. And he opened a widow home in Pune. He also set up Indian Women's University in Bombay in the year 1916. And there are also some other leaders like B.M. Malbari, M.G. Ranade, K. Natarajan. These all people fought for the betterment of women in fighting against the ills against women. See, you need to remember the names and their acts and their works also, because they might come in match the following. This chapter is very important regarding modern history. See, this person is D.K. Kharve. There was an Indian postage that is released with his picture. And now we will see about the child marriage. Who worked for the child marriage? See, a person called B.M. Malbari. He is a Parsi. He fought for the introduction of Age of Consent Act 1891, which means he said there should be some limit that girls can't be married under this age. Like that, he wanted to decide one reasonable age for the couple. He said it should be 12 for the girls. See, in present times, 12 is like very, very less. But in those times, the marriage used to happen at the age of 7 or 8, right? So during that time, 12 is like the beginning of the improvement. And there was Sarda Act 1930. In that, it was decided that for girls, the minimum age should be 14 and for boys it should be 18. So remember, Sharda Act 1930 is related to child marriage, and there was Child Marriage Restraint Act in which 18 is decided for girls, which means less than 18 they should not be married, and 21 is decided for boys. See, it is in the year 1978, and almost in today's time also this is followed.